Now I am going to cover PowerVM VIOS and IBM. So in the sessions, I am going to cover evolutions of PowerVM, what is PowerVM VIOS, what are the benefits we should get from here, what are the benefits we need to create a DIY helper, and its architecture. So now I am going to check about the evolutions of PowerVM. Basically, in earlier days, the S1 system engineers were limited to one logical server per physical server. And if you want to grow your S1 environment, you have to buy a new S1 server. You can see here, those are the 840 modules, 270 modules, 270, and 810 modules. If you want to grow your environment, you have to buy a new S1 server for that. And if you have some spare resources that available with you and you want to share with other servers, you cannot do it easily. You have to bring down the servers, move from one server and put it on the other servers. So a lot of manual efforts were there in earlier days. So in the year of 1999, during B4 or 4 operating systems time, the primary partition and secondary partition concepts comes. Okay, so how many of you have worked on primary partition and secondary partitions?
So how it was? How you work? This is
primary secondary partition. If you need to be down the primary partition, first we have to secondary bring down, then primary. And when we started again, start the primary, then start the secondary, is a dependency each of other. So without any single partition cannot down immediately. So it's a loss if anything happens in a single helper. So we need to be down fully boxed and start the sequence wise.
Any other have worked on the primary partition, secondary partition? Ajay, have you got chance to work on it?
No.
Basically, during B4 or 4 operating systems time, primary partition and secondary partition concepts comes, where primary partition can create and manage all other secondary partitions. And if you want to move some memory and processor in between partitions, without doing IPL, that cannot be effected on it. The main problem was, if the primary partition fails or goes down, your whole environment will be goes down. So to overcome this problem, IBM introduced the logical partition technology, where you can run the helpers independently and managed by hardware management console called HMC. Furthermore, development on helper technology, it became possible to dynamically manage the resources and micro-partitioning of your physical processors through hypervisor. The PowerVM hypervisor technology is integrated with all IBM ICD servers, PCB servers, and some of the blade center servers into single power systems as a server firmware, where you can run multiple operating systems like IMI, AIX, and Linux in a single power system machines. Okay, and where you can virtualize the processors up to 0.05, earlier it was 0.1, now it can be possible to up to 0.5. That means if you have the one core machine, you can create 20 helpers on it. Earlier it was 10. And also, due to this PowerVM hypervisor, you can move the resources in between partitions without any business down there. Right. Earlier it was you have to bring down the helpers, but today's day you no need to be down the helpers, you can move dynamically because of PowerVM hypervisor. Okay. Around since 2004, IBM introduced the VIO technology. Here you can see, 2004, IBM introduced the VIO technology that initially can support some AIX and Linux on Power 5 machines. 4 years later, that also can support on IBM i platforms on Power 6 machines, starting with V6, R1 onwards. And now this is a standard for many organizations. You can buy only one machine and you can run multiple operating systems on it, like IBM, AIX and Linux. Before proceeding to my next slide, I assume most of you must give thoughts, what is VIO, how it works, what is it exactly? Can you, anyone tell about VIOs? Anyone?
AIX, AIX platform, and we are managing all the resources what we are sharing among the L power 5 series or Linux or whatever we built on our power 8 or power 7. So we can share by a wire server. So this is how what the configuration we are doing, sharing the resources, everything will be done on wires. That is managed by AIX, because we, that is not actually the IBM I think. This is something that we are expecting from Linux or AIX.
To all the parts and VIO is the VIO server, and this of these is called the VIO clients.
Yeah, actually both are right, because on AIX standpoint and IBM standpoint, both are right. So basically it's a LPAR creates on power system machines and controlled by hardware management console. Okay, it's owned all the hardware devices. You can say SCSI adapters, 512 adapters, or Ethernet adapters, and CD DVD optical devices is owning, and also it share with other client partitions.
So virtualize the resources.
So basically, it's own all the hardware resources and allow to share with client partitions. So what is VIO server? VIO server is which partitions that own the devices. All the hardware is called VIO server, and the partitions are using it is called VIO client. Client means the IMI, AIX, Linux. So now I am coming to PowerVM VIOS. So what is PowerVM VIOS? It's basically a combination in between your hardware additions and value added softwares. It comes with PowerVM Enterprise Edition and Standard Editions. It's a license feature. So it's basically a software appliance built in top of AIX, but not AIX partitions. It's a specialized flavor of for your AIX partition, means AIX operating systems, you can say like that. Okay. It provides virtualized IO virtualizations, means it's virtualized all the hardware devices and shared among the client partitions, maybe the IMI or AIX on Linux. First available in 2004. To support AIX and Linux partitions on Power 5 machines. On IBM I, 4 years later in 2008, it supports Power 6 machines. Operating systems V6 R1 onwards. And it is licensed with PowerVM up to Power 8, you have to pay to IBM for the licenses. And Power 9 onwards, it comes with bundle. So what are the benefits you should get from VIOS? This will reduce physical footprint of your data centers and less power consumption. And by sharing the physical resources like SCSI adapter, fiber channel adapter, and Ethernet adapters, and your external SAN storage, it will drastically reduce the physical footprint of your data centers. And also less power consumption is required because less hardware you are using. You can see in the address like your production is running on 840 watts, development server is running on the 270 watts, and test helper is running on 810 watts, and all the physical hardware is attached to your dashboard storage. Okay, so lot of space is required in earlier days. And also each physical box requires side A power and side B power to run on it. So lot of power outlets and lot of space is required if you run the physical boxes. But now you have to run only power system machines and attach the storage on it, and you can create multiple LPARs and The multiple helpers can be IMI, AIX and Linux. Cost efficient standpoint, power customers can buy fewer hardware resources like IO devices, means all the IO adapters and processors are being shared with multiple clients, IBM, AIX and Linux. That's why you no need to buy maximum hardware. And also, you no need to buy the each dedicated helper, you no need to buy the physical hardware because everything is shared. As an example, one HBA card costs $6,000. Okay, and if you are running 20 helpers, you need 20 HBA card. Cost will be $120,000. Instead of that, one or two card can be virtualized and shared among all other 20 helpers. So you will save a huge cost here. And also, operating system licenses cost will be less because you are using only one operating system. You are paid to IBM for only your one operating system. Okay, that's why you have to pay less for operating system. And you can create multiple helpers on it. And also, AMC maintenance cost will be less. Resource optimizations. Unused CPU cycles, which are not used, that can be dynamically assigned to other helpers where need be. And it is increased reliability, availability, and flexibility. By applying the redundant VIOs in your environment, you can configure the dual path, primary path and secondary path of these VIOs, and that can be, means if one VIOs fails, then other can take care of. In that means whole environment will be up and running every time. And flexibility also is there because you can create the helper quickly because all the hardware are being virtualized. And if you have the storage available with you and you can attach it, then you can create the helpers quickly and share it to your developer team to perform their retrace activity or test kind of activity, they can do it. And PowerVM makes IBMI cloud possible because, as you know, all the hardware are being virtualized, and if you can take a powerful machines like 192 core machines, and you can create hundreds of helpers on it, and you can host it multiple customers on this single hardware, and you can install the different operating systems like IMI, AIX, and Linux, and share with the multiple customers. In that way, the cloud is possible. So, what are the prerequisite to create a VIOS helper? You need power 6 machine onwards. Any machine make power 8 or power 9. Now it is power 9 is running. And you need hardware and console to create your VIO server and VIO client. And you need storage adapter to connect your physical disk. This can be 30 GB. It is the minimum requirement. Ethernet adapter to connect your network card. Processor at least 0.05 processors, memory at least 128 MB in the VR. Those are the minimum requirements to create your VIOS. Now I'm coming to architecture of VIOS. So here you can see your Ethernet and storage is attached directly to your VIO servers, and this is PowerVM hypervisor. All the hardwares are being virtualized here and create one virtualized ID and assign to your guest helper. So this is not visible properly. Those are the guest helper, and the guest helper can be the IMI or AIX or Linux. Here, PowerVM hypervisor is running your top of your hardware, and your operating system is running on top of your PowerVM hypervisor. It's a between layer in between your hardware and operating systems. That's why it is being possible 100% virtualization. And we can see here Ethernet and storage, physical devices also attached with one guest helper, because this helper is directly attached. This, some customers are using it because of compliance issue, means they no need to share this physical hardware with other servers because of any hardware or means compliance requirement is there. That's why they need to share with other helpers, other customers. And but this customer will not take the benefit of the virtualizations. And here you can see HMC attached, because HMC is required to create your VIO helper and client helpers. Okay, and this also redundant if one goes down then other can take care. And also it is required to activate your not activate the helpers, up and down of the helper, this is required. And here VIO is taking care of your it is redundant, one VIOS fails, then other VIO can take care of your whole environment. And it is a software that is located in a special partition that is not intended to run end user applications. Means in VIO servers, you cannot run your business applications like JTAGOVERS, PowerVM, XTOL, ADI, like HF 400, Group MQ series, you cannot run it here because this is required to manage your virtualized environment. This is for you guys only, as it will provide you the administrative console, you can manage your virtualized environment. And it can support the IBM, AIX and Linux, three operating systems. So there are two types of virtualization techniques. VIOS basically virtualized the physical and Ethernet adapter, physical part of the storage and network virtualizations. So here you can see the Ethernet and storage, it attached to your SAN switch, and all the hardware are reporting to VIOS helper. Here it is virtualized and create the virtual ID, and that is assigned to your client helpers. Client helper can be the IMI, AIX and Linux. So now I come to storage virtualization technique. So there are two types of virtualization. One is disk-AC, other one is NVMe. Some customers are also using disk-AC, and most of all customers are using the NVMe. We are going to see how it is connected. So this is the disk-AC technique. Here you can see this is your storage, maybe the disk XIB or D7000 or DS8K kind of storage. It is attached to your virtual server's KC interface. Okay, and the VIOS own these hardwares and maintain a client server relationship in between your IBM I and VIOS. Once its LAN is created here and it is accessed by IBM I, you can see the non-configured status of your LANs in your AS content green screen. The type should be the 6D22. If you run the command work with this status, and you can see the type 6B22. That means it is coming through BSKC adapters. Okay, the BSKC adapter, SAN can be managed on both the side, on VIO side and storage side as well. One LAN support 30 disks and no tape will be supported. There are two limitations because it is 32 is means the not that much disk supported, so it is less, and no tape will be supported. So that can be overcome in NPIB. So it's import IP virtualizations. Here it is happening, the SAN storage is directly connected to your IMI. VIOS is not coming in between. It is act as a pass-through of your the fiber channel adapter card is directly connected from your IBMI and DSLK. That is because of NPIB. NPIB is a feature of your PowerVM. Okay. Once LANs are created here, and you can see on IBMI side non-configured status, and you can add it to your ASP, and whatever you want to do, you can do it from the green screen. And if you run the command work with this status, you can see the type should be 2107 and 2145. Here, each DFC adapter supports 127 LANs, that is 4 times higher than this DFC adapters. Okay. Here is tape library supported. And storage management is done from storage only, because it is passing through the VIOS. So, can anyone tell what the difference between this case and FPIB? We will discuss now this case and FPIB. What are the differences between this case and FPIB? Okay, so here you can see what are the differences. Is it visible? This case, here you can see SAN is assigned to IBM partitions through VIOS, and NPIB it is assigned to IBM directly because it is passing through the fiber channel of the car. It is direct connection in between your IBM and SAN storage. SAN storage can be like DS83 or D7000. Storage management is done from both SAN and VIOS. Because here it owns all the hardware, that's why it's possible to manage the SAN, VIOS side as well as SAN storage side. But in NPIB, it is supported only from managed only from storage side only. And 32 disks supported, and here is 4 times higher than this case, 127 answer supported at NPIB. And it is no tape learning supported and tape learning supported. Any questions on this case and NPIB or understood correctly? Okay. Now I am going to network virtualization. So there are two types of network virtualization technique. One is shared independent adapter and SRIO. So I am coming to ACA first. ACA, basically objective is we have the one network card, right? One Ethernet card. That can be virtualized by using VIOS. And can be shared across multiple time records. One card can be shared multiple records. How it is happening, we can understand that. Okay. So this is your physical adapter and this is your BIOS helper. Here with ACA, the shared Ethernet adapter bridge is there. You can see here. It's a component of BIOS. And we have to create one bridge in between your one port of the physical Ethernet card and one or more port of the BIOS adapters. That will create one bridge in between your physical Ethernet card and the iOS. Okay. Once bridge is there, then you can create one VLAN here to connect your client partitions, and that VLAN also can be connected to your external switch to see the outside world. Okay. Here, traffic is passing from your physical card to airport I am using BIOS and power hypervisor. Okay, that's why latency is high because power hypervisor is copying the packets in between your client partitions and VIO partitions. If you use the 10 Gbps card, 10 Gb card, only it is using 2.8 Gbps throughput you are getting through ACA. Okay, and ACA and VLAN is also running on the VIO helpers, that's why it is taking more CPU of the BIOS helper and memory as well. So it is impacted the BIOS helper's performance. So two overheads here. One is low efficiency. Okay, and another one is BIOS helper personal performance is impacted. And the real adapter can be the physical Ethernet adapter, a link aggregation or type of the Ethernet card basically. So two overheads here, so that can be mitigated in SRIO. So need to understand how SRIO card is virtualized. So this is a special type of SRIO Ethernet card. Okay. So this card can be accessed in two ways. One is dedicatedly you can assign to Helpa, and also this card can be used as a shared mode. If you want to access as a shared mode, then you have to go to HLC, enable from there under a tag properties and IO tags. You will get the, you will see the enable of this card. You can click it enable, then it will be enable and create multiple logical code on this card. Okay, so here you can see. This port can be directly packet to your L bar, means one port of the logical port and another port of the client L bar that can be directly connected, and one port can be go to VIOS L bar, and it is virtualized here and passing through the hypervisor and connected to your L bar C, another L bar, client L bar. So there are four deployment method of this card. One is radically you can use, another one is with VIOS, this one is without VIOS, and L bar B is connected, one port is connected through VIOS and other port is connected directly. So what the benefit you should get from here, this card is not passing through the VIOS, that's why it is not taking, but means it is not creating ACA kind of thing, or it is not taking more VIOS CPU and memory, that's why performance will not be impacted here. And if you use the 10 Gbps card, you can get the throughput 9.1 Gbps. So much more higher than ACA. And this card is coming through 10 Gbps, 20 Gbps, 40 and 100. If you use the 100 Gbps card, you can share among 120 L-bars. This only one card can support 120 L-bars. And one VNIC technique, it's a virtual network interface controller technique, has been added to boost up this performance. And it supports live partition mobility, because once it's passing through the VIOS, that also supports to live partition mobility. Now I'm coming to what the difference between ACA and SRL. In ACA, we have seen no direct access, only passing through the VIOS. And SRLOB, it is direct access and also using the VIOS. Means we can, there are deployment method is multiple way we can use this card. And here you can see that for a 10 Gbps card, you can get the throughput is 2.8 Gbps. And for SRLOB, for 10 Gbps card, you can get a 9.1 Gbps. And it is higher latency and CPU utilization because passing through the VIOS and taking VIOS server CPU memory, that's why the high latency and CPU utilization, and here lower latency and CPU utilization because it is not using the VIOS server CPU memory. And it is eligible for LPM, as my covering light partition mobility, LPM requires 100% virtualization. So ACA provides 100% of network configuration because it is passing through the VIOS. And for SRLOB also passing through VIOS once you use the VNIC technique. If it is going to directly to, if it is going to directly from this port, like this one, that will not support your live partition mobility. So now I'm coming to VIOS LNS architecture. So here you can see all the yellow colors are the physical hardware, like your SAN storage, SAN disk, SAN switches, and physical adapters. On top of that, your VIOS server is running the VIOS 1 and VIOS 2. And on top of the VIOS, either my client partitions or any other client partitions can sit in. And your red color is the primary path, and blue color is the secondary path that can be connected. If one VIO goes fails, then your client partition can see the SAN storage by using the second VIOS. Okay, if one VIOS fails and another one path is failed, primary path or secondary path fails, then again it will be connected to your client partitions. So it is redundant in full way, and also avoid interruption of hardware failure. If any physical hardware fails, then we have the four physical cards and all are virtualized. So there is no problem once the physical hardware fails. And VIOS maintenance, without any vigilance, downtime, you can upgrade your firmwares. That time you can down this VIOS, and another one VIOS can take care of the whole load, and also support the load balancing, because once you do the architecture of this connectivity of this VIOS to client partitions, then 50% of the connection will be coming through one VIO, and 50% of the connection will be coming through secondary VIOS. So it is load balancing is also done here. So now I come to best practices. So keep your VIOS servers updated, because once you log in for with IBM, they will ask you first, what is your firmware level, what is your VIOS level. So before that, you can update your firmware regularly and implement VIOS what VIOS server. If 2, that is good. If 4, there is no problems. And implement fully virtualized environment that will support your live partition mobility. Add virtual workers and the VIOS servers and client partitions as DGR mode, because you will be using the fully utilized the virtualization environment, the cost saving point of view. And install VIOS internal disk. VIOS servers disk is assigned because it's less complicated. And implement the following weight setting. When you assign the processors, it will become more weightage. Although it's 0.05, but weightage should be more to take care of the performance of the VIOS. And keep an eye on the server performance. The couple of tools are there, like VIOS advisor or HMC scanner. You can implement in your environment and do the regular monitoring on it. So any questions from anyone on the other side? Please. Thank you. I say.